Ian Clunies Ross died in June 1959. Now, through the establishment of the Ian Clunies Ross Memorial Foundation, a national science center is planned. The center, to be known as Clunies Ross House, will honor the man who, for 10 years as chairman of CSIRO, guided and inspired the growth of science and its application to Australian development. Here on a site at Parkville near the University of Melbourne, some 30 different scientific and technical societies will integrate and pursue their respective fields of endeavor. Science and technology, on which national prosperity so largely depends, will further advance through the Clunies Ross Foundation. Sir Ian Clunies Ross was a man of many interests. Throughout his career from the University of Sydney, where he graduated as a Bachelor of Veterinary Science, to the chairmanship of CSIRO, he saw the urgent need for the application of science to Australia's primary and secondary industries. His own early research was in the field of parasitology, but in later years, through his foresight and initiative, new fields of agricultural and industrial research were started. His burning conviction that science must be harnessed for the good of the community made these changes felt throughout the Australian continent. He was fully aware of the role the universities had to play in the Australian life. Through his membership of the Murray Committee and his association with the Council of the Australian National University and the University of Melbourne, he greatly assisted in improving the conditions and status of our universities. The interests of Clunies Ross were not restricted to CSIRO alone. He was genuinely interested in what others were doing, the universities, the state research bodies, private industry. This man hated racial prejudice. Through his interest in the peoples of Southeast Asia, he helped establish International House, where overseas students could live and exchange ideas with their Australian colleagues. During his chairmanship of CSIRO, Clunies Ross was responsible for the establishment of many new fields of research and for the extension of others. He also knew the value of using knowledge already gained to extend and improve primary and secondary industry. The name of Clunies Ross will always be associated with the Australian wool industry, for it was due largely to his efforts that the Wool Research Fund was established, a fund that was to prove invaluable in restoring wool to a favorable position in the textile world. As Clunies Ross himself said, growers all over the world today recognize that research can do and is doing a great deal, not only to improve the production of wool in the field, but in improving the properties of wool as a textile fiber for the manufacture of material and clothing. Because of the necessity to develop our tropical and subtropical regions, Clunies Ross set up the CSIRO Division of Tropical Pastures. Research in this division has already shown the way for an increase in the carrying capacity of Queensland pastures. New forms of land and pasture reclamation were developed. In Australia, 600 million rabbits were eating as much pasture as 75 million sheep. With the introduction of myxomatosis, 9/10 of this menace were wiped out. Biological control was applied to fruit and crop pests and certain types of weeds. Research into the arid areas of the north resulted in new and better pastures, permitting cattle to graze on land previously dominated by wind and sun. The hard, dry earth began at last to bear life. The use of gypsum in irrigation water was found to increase the growth of clover on previously unyielding soil. And to aid natural rainfall, experiments were carried out into methods of creating artificial rain. Studies of cloud and ice crystal formation were made, while aircraft and high-altitude balloons were used to gather meteorite dust from the atmosphere, a dust associated with the theory of natural rainfall. Dry ice and silver iodide were used in cloud seeding experiments, which resulted in a considerable increase in the rainfall over selected test areas. To further assist the water conservation so necessary to this country, experiments were carried out in the field of evaporation control. By covering the water surface area with a thin film of cetyl alcohol, evaporation loss was, in many cases, reduced by up to 60%. The standard of beef and dairy cattle improved as science sought and found the answers to many age-old problems. Diseases were eliminated or controlled. Hardier strains were introduced, better to withstand the varied Australian conditions. A revolutionary method of cheesemaking was developed, a method which has already been adopted by many countries overseas. Scientists explored the world below the surface of the sea to develop new and more efficient ways to reap its harvest. Commonwealth and state departments, universities and industry were all associated with these research developments and with Australia's progress. Research was carried out into the building trade, solving problems associated with building for our modern age. New materials were developed to reduce the demand on Australia's forests, while methods to better utilise our limited timber resources were tried with success. Mining companies perfected the separation of lead and zinc by flotation processes. CSIRO set up a division of coal research. The Australian aeronautics industry had been established. Science even looked to the stars. Through the study of radio physics, dark corners of the universe became familiar. The giant silhouette of radio telescopes has heralded the challenge of the space age, a challenge that science is prepared to meet. Science in Australia is progressing rapidly. The benefits of this science are reaped by the people of this country in improved living standards and new fields of industrial and commercial development. This, then, was the life of Ian Clunies Ross, a man of vision who believed in science and the free exchange of ideas.
But still, we're only at the beginning of the development of this country. There are many other great problems to be solved, and for these we need many more young men and women of the highest quality to undertake this work of solving the problems of industry and helping to develop their country.
Engineers, botanists, chemists, biologists. These and many more are playing their part in the scientific growth of their country, as individuals and as members of various societies and organizations. These societies will find a common center at Clunies Ross House, a center to provide leadership and unity to all branches of science and technology. From this center will flow the rewards of this science to industry and to commerce, to people on the land, to every citizen. The value of the National Science Centre to the Australian community is expressed in the words of Sir Macfarlane Burnet.
Perhaps one of the greatest virtues of Clunies Ross House will be to supply a centre and meeting place for people concerned with a wide range of scientific disciplines. People, in fact, who are concerned with bringing science to every section of the community. Opportunities for contact and cooperation are just as important for the advance and application of science as they are for increasing goodwill between men in such fields as commerce and politics.
This will be the function of the National Science Centre. It will be an investment in the scientific future of Australia. An investment for every primary producer and manufacturer. An investment paying rich dividends in years to come. This is what Ian Clunies Ross would have wished. An end to which he shaped his life as a man of science.